Today we'll begin the text of Taker's play, The Shoemaker's Holiday. Yesterday I uploaded the synopsis of the play on Google Classroom. So, the few initial words about the play that is there in the synopsis. The Shoemaker's Holiday or The Gentle Craft is an Elizabethan play written by Thomas Dekker. The play was first performed in 1599 by the Admiral's Men, and it falls into the subgenre of city comedy. The story features three subplots: an interclass romance between a citizen of London and an aristocrat, the ascension of shoemaker Simon Eyre to Lord Mayor of London, and a romance between a gentleman and a shoemaker's wife, whose husband appears to have died in the wars with France. So, apart from the two love plots, the two romantic plots, we have the story of the rise of Simon Eyre. So, Simon Eyre is also therefore a central character of the play, even though he is not the conventional romantic hero. I skip the dedication to all good fellows, professors of the gentle craft, of what degree soever. I come to, then we see the prologue. I am skipping the prologue also. Then we have two songs. The first three man's song and the second three man's song. So these songs will be sung at different points in the play. Three man song means that three male voices will sing together. So I'm skipping the songs and I'm coming to the text of the play, scene one. So Lincoln and Otley, they are having a conversation. "My Lord Mayor, you have sundry times feasted myself and many courtiers more. Seldom or never can you be so kind to make requital of your courtesy. But leaving this, I hear my cousin Lacey is much affected to your daughter Rose." So the Lord Mayor and the aristocratic men, they would often have various interactions. And Lincoln praises the Lord Mayor and then says that cousin is a term which may mean nephew or any relative. So he says that my cousin Lacey is much affected to your daughter Rose. That is, he seems to have fallen in love with your daughter Rose. "Hotly, true, my good lord, and she loves him so well that I mislike her boldness in the chase." So you see that from the beginning the romantic love affair is described in terms of the chase. And in the play itself, there is a chase by the city gentleman Hammond. But chase here metaphorically stands also for romantic pursuit of a girl. So Otley says that, "I mislike her boldness in the chase." That is, my daughter is too bold to accept the love propositions of Roland Lacey. So he expresses his disapproval of this love relationship. "Why, my Lord Mayor, think you it then a shame to join a Lacey with an Otley's name?" Lincoln asks that whether Otley thinks that the name of the noble family of Lacey is not desirable for the purpose of marriage. "Too mean is my poor girl for his high birth. Poor citizens must not with courtiers wed, who will in silks and gay apparel spend more in 1 year than I am worth by far. Therefore your honor need not doubt my girl." So Otley expresses the typical middle class disapproval of the extravagance of the nobility. So he says that a girl from a middle class should not marry a nobleman or a courtier because a courtier would spend a lot of money after silk and gay apparel. So here we see the first mention of the luxury goods, which is a hallmark of this play, that I already told you, luxury items or luxury goods, commodities, they have a particular place, a special place in this play. But here Otley expresses his disapproval that the noble men, they often spend beyond their means, they are extravagant, and a nobleman like that would spend much more than I can ever earn. You need not doubt, my girl, that my daughter has any other emotion, any other sentiment in this matter excepting love, because Lincoln was suggesting that whether there is a kind of social disapproval of the nobility. But Otley says no, it is not a social disapproval, but it is the question of finance. So for girls from poor families or middle class families, for them it would be disastrous to marry a nobleman in financial terms. Take it, my lord, advise you what you do. A verier unthrift lives not in the world than is my cousin. For I will tell you what, 'tis now almost a year since he requested to travel countries for experience. I furnished him with coin, bills of exchange, letters of credit, men to wait on him, solicited my friends in Italy, well, to respect him. But to see the end, scant had he journeyed through half Germany, but all his coin was spent, his men cast off, his bills embezzled, and my jolly cause assumed to show his bankrupt presence here, became a shoemaker in Wittenberg. A goodly science for a gentleman of such descent. Now judge the rest by this. Suppose your daughter have £1,000, he did consume me more in 1/2 year, and make him heir to all the wealth you have, 1 12-month's rioting will waste it all. Then seek, my lord, some honest citizen to wed your daughter to. So Lincoln says that my nephew wanted to go abroad for experience, and I provided him with money, coins, bill of exchange, letters of credit, and servants, and I told my friends in Italy about his arrival. But only half through his travel, he has spent all his money, and his servants were thrown out, and his bills mounted, and he returns almost bankrupt. And he was forced to learn the craft of shoemaking. And here Lincoln is being sarcastic. A goodly science for a gentleman of such descent. That is, a nobleman should not learn shoemaking. But because of his desperate, extravagant expenditure, he was forced to learn shoemaking to survive. And he learned it in Wittenberg. And therefore, he consumed more than £1,000 in 1/2 year. Therefore, I advise you to get some honest citizen for your daughter's husband, as your daughter's husband, and not my nephew. So both Otley and Lincoln express their several reasons of disapproval of the relationship between Lacy and Rose. I thank your lordship in an aside. Well, Fox, I understand your subtlety. As for your nephew, let your lordship's eye but watch his actions, and you need not fear, for I have sent my daughter far enough. So from this aside, where Otley calls him Fox, we see the undercurrent of hostility between the middle class and the aristocrats. So the middle class people don't trust the aristocrats. And he says in this aside that you need not fear that there will be any development here, because you only take care of your nephew. I have sent my daughter to a faraway place. And yet your cousin Roland might do well. Now he has learned an occupation. So your good for nothing nephew, now that he has learned shoemaking, he may do earn something. And then he says, and yet I scorn to call him son-in-law. So I will never accept him as my son-in-law. Lincoln, I have a better trade for him. I thank his grace he hath appointed him chief colonel of all those companies mastered in London and the shires about, to serve his highness in those wars of France. So alluding to the French wars of the 15th century, Lincoln says that I have found a better occupation for him, better than that of shoemaking. That is, he will serve as a soldier or a captain, a colonel in fact, in this war in France, for which soldiers are being recruited from throughout the realm. Then Lovell, Lacy and Eskew entered. See where he comes. Lovell, what news with you? My Lord of Lincoln, it is His Highness's will that presently your cousin ship for France with all his powers. He would not for a million, but they should land at Dieppe within 4 days. So, the king's instruction that the soldiers should immediately depart for France, and since Lacy is a colonel in that war, so he should also go. And Lincoln says, go certify his grace, it shall be done. Does you tell the king that it will be done. Now, cousin Lacy, in what forwardness are all your companies? What is the exact status of your soldiers? Lacy, all well prepared. The men of Hertfordshire lie at Mile End. Suffolk and Essex train in Tothill Fields. The Londoners and those of Middlesex all gallantly prepared to Finsbury, with frolic spirits long for their parting hour. So he says that all the soldiers from the different provinces, they are doing their drills, their exercises, and they are in good mood and eager to participate in the war. Otley, they have their impressed coats and furniture, and if it please your cousin Lacy, come to the guild hall, he shall receive his pay, and £20 besides my brethren will freely give him to approve our loves we bear unto my lord your uncle here. Otley, as the mayor, says that Lacy should go to the guild hall, where he will be given the payment for the purpose of war, and he will be given an additional £20 because of my appreciation and respect for his uncle, that is Lincoln. So we see that Otley is too eager for Lacy to leave England, and to expedite that, he is paying £20 extra, so that by the lure of the money, Lacy leaves England and leaves Rose in peace. Then they would assemble at the Guild Hall. So we see here a reference to the Guild Hall, and at the end of the play, we will see that Simon Eyre would pray to the king, and that the king would grant him the use of the Guild Hall for the purpose of the shoe business or leather business on particular days of the week. So the Guild Hall is an important reference here, because it points to the practice of shoemaking, the different crafts, and the guild institutions of London. Lincoln, to approve your loves to me, no subtlety, nephew, that £20 he doth bestow for joy to rid you from his daughter Rose. So Lincoln says that Otley is not paying £20 because he appreciates me, There is no certainty in this. He is actually paying the extra money to get rid of you, so that you do not disturb his daughter. But cousins both, now we are none but friends. I would not have you cast an amorous eye upon so mean a project as the love of a gay wanton-painted citizen. Otley has left by saying that we expect everybody in the guild hall, and therefore Lincoln says in his absence that I do not want you to indulge in such a mean project, amorous eye, that is looking at a girl of the middle class as a lover. So you are not to fall in love with a middle class girl who is described as gay, wanton, painted citizen. Citizen means middle class. Gay and wanton, these are both negative attributes or adjectives suggesting the kind of immorality of the citizens or the middle class people. So here we see the class hostility of the nobles against the middle class people. I pray thee do thou so. Remember cause, what honorable fortunes wait on thee. Increase the king's love which so brightly shines and gilds thy hopes. Have no heir but thee, and yet not thee, if with a wayward spirit thou start from the true bias of my love. So the uncle says that you are my only heir, but you will not remain my heir if you continue to behave in this wayward fashion by bestowing love on undeserving candidates. On the other hand, he advises Lacy to satisfy the king, because the king's love, if the king's love increases, then he will be advanced in his situation more and more. My lord, I will for honor, not desire of hand, land or livings, or to be your heir. So guide my actions in pursuit of France, as shall add glory to the Lacy's name. So here Lacy is being diplomatic and says that I will advance the reputation of your family name, the name of the Lacy, by my achievements, my enterprises in France. Cause for those words, here is 30 potogs, and nephew Askew, there is a few for you. Fair honor in her loftiest eminence stays in France for you till you fetch her thence. Then nephews, clap swift wings on your designs. Begone, begone, make haste to the guild hall. There presently I will meet you. Do not stay. Where honor beckons, shame attends delay. So Lincoln gives Lacy 30 potogs. Now potog was a Portuguese gold coin, and one potog was equivalent to 4 pounds. So 30 potogs would be equivalent to 120 pounds, which was a lot of money in those days. So Lincoln gives Lacy lots of money so that he goes to France and does not continue his relationship with Rose in London. So both Lacy and Lincoln speak of honor, as honor being the aim of his actions. So according to the values of nobility, honor was the most important, and both of them speak of honor. But we will see that Lacy does not so much pursue his honor, because he does not go to join the war in France or to fight. On the other hand, he stays back, and not only does he indulge in many love intrigues, but he takes the guise of shoemaker, which was considered mean and dishonorable from the point of view of the nobility. Then Lacy tells Askew, after Lincoln leaves, Askew says, how gladly would your uncle have you gone? That is, your uncle is so desirous of you leaving England, unless it's a true cause, but I will overreach his policies. So policy here means plan or plot. I will overreach his policies, that is, I will foil his plans. I have some serious business for 3 days, which nothing but my presence can dispatch. Now this serious business was none other than making love to Rose. But he doesn't say that to Askew. He makes him believe that he will be busy with some important work. You therefore, cousin, with the companies, shall haste to Dover. So he sends in his place Askew to Dover. There I will meet with you, or if I stay past my prefixed time, away for France, we will meet in Normandy. So he says that I will catch up with you, either in Dover, or if I cannot reach Dover on time, then you leave for France and I will meet you in Normandy, that is in France itself. So we can realize that Lacy is deceiving Askew. He does not have any plans of ever going to France. The £20 my Lord Mayor gives to me, you shall receive, and these 10 potags, part of mine uncle's 30. So that Askew does not foil his plans, or so that Askew obeys him. He gives him, almost like bribe, he gives him extra money. From the money given by the mayor, he gives him 10 potags, 20 pounds, and from the money he received from his uncle, he gives 10 potags to Askew. So he bribes him with this money so that he goes to France in his place. Gentle cause hath cared to our great change. I know your wisdom hath tried itself in higher consequence. So you take care of our great charge, that is the responsibilities about the war. You take the responsibility of this duty. I know that you have previously, you had participated in such great action. Cause all myself am yours, yet have this care to lodge in London with all secrecy. Our uncle Lincoln hath, besides his own, many a jealous eye that in your face stares only to watch means for your disgrace. So Askew is clever enough, he has understood that Lacy has no plans of leaving London. So he says that you be careful, because our uncle Lincoln, he has spies at many places, so he will be watching, and you must be careful that you are not caught. So after this, Simon, Eyre, Marjorie, Hodge, Firk, Jane and Ralph, they enter. And with this, we have this, we are introduced to the group of shoemakers, and Simon's wife Marjorie. Then Eyre says, Eyre has this his own peculiar way of speaking. Leave whining, away with this whimpering, this puling, these blubbering tears and these wet eyes. I will get thy husband discharged. I warrant thee, sweet Jane, go to. So Ralph's wife, Jane, apparently has come to petition Simon to intercede on her behalf. And Simon says, do not whine, do not cry. I will have your husband. Then Hodge says, master, here be the captain. So by that he refers to Lacy, because Lacy is the colonel in charge of all the soldiers. Peace, Hodge. Hushed, you knave, hushed. So Simon always tells others to shut up. Here he also tells Hodge to shut up. And Firk says, here be the cavaliers and the colonel's master. Peace, Firk, peace, my fine Firk. Stand by with your pishery-pashery, away. This phrase, pishari bashari, it means obsolete nonce word. It does not have any particular meaning. A cheerfully dismissive term favored by ire. And he repeats this term, pishari bashari, that is, stop all this nonsense. It does not have any particular meaning. I am a man of the best presence. I will speak to them, and they were popes. And here means as if. So I will speak to the cornels as if they were popes. That is, I will speak to them respectfully. Gentlemen, captains, cornels, commanders, brave men, brave leaders, may it please you to give me audience. So you see, Simon is being very formal, addressing Lacey. I am Simon Iyer, the mad shoemaker of Tower Street. So that is how he introduces himself, the mad shoemaker of Tower Street. Which signifies that he has a cheerful spirit and humor, and he sarcastically also calls himself mad. This wench with the mealy mouth that will never tire is my wife. Mealy mouth means that one who speaks in a gentle manner. So this woman who will never stop speaking, that is my wife. I can tell you, here is Hodge, my man, and my foreman. Here is Firk, my fine Firking journeyman. Now, in the name of Firk, obviously Dacre uses a pun, an obscene pun. Firk here is used with the slang word in mind. All we come to be suitors for this honest Ralph, keep him at home, and as I am a true shoemaker and a gentleman of the gentle craft, buy spurs yourself and I will find you boots these 7 years. So his petition was that Ralph should be spared, and if you spare him, then I will provide you with shoes or boots for the 7 years. And Marjorie is surprised at this offer. 7 years, husband? Peace, Mitri, peace. I know what I do. Peace. So Simon will not let anyone speak, and he calls Marjorie by several kinds of names, all funny. Midriff, because Marjorie is diminutive in stature. And he says that I know what to say, therefore you do not speak. Firk says, truly, Master Cormorant, you shall do good service to let Ralph and his wife stay together. Another malapropism, we may say, but that will be anachronical. That is, comic use of words, wrong words. Here, Firk meant corporal, or colonel, but he says cormorant, which means a vulture-like bird. He says that you should allow Ralph and his wife stay together. She is a young new married woman. If you take her husband away from her a night, you undo her. She may beg in the daytime, for he is as good a workman at a prick and awl as any in our trade. So there are plenty of covert use of slang and allusions to body allusions. Body means kind of vulgar reference to physical acts or sexual acts. So in the speech of the shoemakers, we often have reference to the sexual acts, and that is also common among ordinary people, this vulgar use of words. Prick and awl is a phrase that refers to the instruments of shoemaking, but they also refer to the male and female organs of sex. So Firk says that if you take away her husband, then she will be forced to beg during the day, and at night she will do immoral things. Jane, oh, let him stay, else I shall be undone. I truly she shall be laid at one side like a pair of old shoes else and be occupied for no use. So Fark's allusions are all sexual. Lacey, truly my friends, it lies not in my power. The Londoners are pressed, paid and set forth by the Lord Mayor. I cannot change a man. So Lacey says that the recruitment has been done by the mayor and I cannot change a man. So it is not in my power. Why then you are as good be a corporal as a colonel if you cannot discharge one good fellow? Which means that you do not have any power. And I tell you true, I think you do more than you can answer to press a man within a year and a day of his marriage. So Hodge says that it is very unsympathetic to recruit a man who is newly married. By newly married means married for a year. Well said, melancholy Hodge, Gramercy, my fine foreman. Truly, gentlemen, it were ill done for such as you to stand so stiffly against a poor young wife, considering her case. She is new married, but let that pass. Now, Marjorie also has her own idioms or own ways of speech, and she has a habit of frequently saying, let that pass. I pray deal not roughly with her. Her husband is a young man and but newly entered, but let that pass. So she repeats this phrase again and again to indicate that it is her habit. And in this phrase that do not deal roughly with her, there is sexual allusion. Away with your pishery pashery, you Pauls and you Oedipals, peace midriff, silence. Cecily bum trinket, let your head speak. So Iyer uses various words, unusual words in his language. Pauls and Oedipals, they do not mean anything, but they were swear words. Cecily bum trinket, Iyer uses this phrase later also to refer to Marjorie's maid, but here it applies to Marjorie herself. The name is used by several early modern playwrights as a disparaging term for any female. So Iyer always speaks to his wife in a disparaging way. Fark, yeah, and the horns to masters, which means that that Marjorie is not only a fool but also a devil. Because Iyer says that let your head speak, and Fark says and the horns too, that is horns on the head. Tossun, my fine Fark, tossun. Now this is a Welsh phrase, tossun, which means hold your tongue. Now if you have this edition, then you will get all these explanations in the notes. But I assume that many of you still do not have the book or this particular edition. These scoundrels, you this man captains, you will not release him? Well, let him go. He is a proper shot. Let him vanish. Peace, Jen, dry up the tears. They will make his powder dankish. So, Iyer says that, Jen, you stop crying because your tears will make his gunpowder moist and therefore it will not work during war. Take him, brave men. Hector of Troy was a hackney to him. Hercules and Termagant scoundrels. Prince Arthur's round table by the Lord of Ludgate never fed such a tall, such a dapper swordman. So, Simon is referring to a number of heroes from myth. Termagant is the name of an imaginary deity in medieval Christendom, which often, which it was believed was worshipped by Muslims. So for Christians to say Termagant means that he is a devil. And then Hercules and a knight of Prince Arthur's Round Table, all these suggest that Ralph is a good soldier, or he will be a good soldier, a fine swordsman. Fark, see Hodge, how my master raves in commendation of Ralph. But Ralph, thou art a girl by this hand, and thou goest not. Hodge says that Ralph will be a fool and you should not go. But Simon is praising him so that he gets flattered and he goes. Askew, I am glad, good master Ayer, it is my hap to meet to so resolute a soldier. Trust me for your report and love to him. A common slight regard shall not respect him. Then Lacy speaks to Ralph. Is thy name Ralph? Yes, sir. Give me thy hand. Thou shalt not want, as I am a gentleman. Thou shalt not want, that is, you will be well paid. I am a woman, be patient. God no doubt will send thy husband safe again, but he must go. So he tells Jane that you must be patient, because if God wills, then he will come back, but you have to let him go. His country's quarrel says it shall be so. So the fight, England's fight against other countries, against France, compels him to participate in that fight. So it is a call by the country, and here is an evocation of a sense of patriotism or nationalism. Thou art a gull by my stirrup. If thou dost not go, I will not have thee strike thy gimlet into these weak vessels. Prick thine enemies, Ralph. So Hodge says that if you do not go, then you are a gull. That is, you are foolish. So you are called to war. So you should definitely go and participate in this war. Otherwise, you will have no right to have sex. He uses the phrase, strike thy gimlet into these weak vessels. Traditionally, weak vessel refer to a woman in the biblical tradition. But striking the gimlet into the weak vessel, that also refers to the craft of shoemaking. Prick thine enemies. That is, since you cannot prick your wife, so go and prick your enemies. Here the here sex is looked upon as a metaphor for war, or the same kind of encounter. Then Dodger enters and tells Lacy, your uncle on the Tower Hill stays with the Lord Mayor and the aldermen, and doth request you with all speed you may to hasten thither. So Lacy is expected at the Tower Hill. Lacy, Dodger, run you before, tell them we come. This Dodger is mine uncle's parasite, the arrantest varlet that ever breathed on earth. So he hates Dodger because Dodger is Lincoln's spy. By one day's broaching of his pig-thunk tails, then can be salved again in 20 years. And he, I fear, shall go with us to France to pry into our actions. So he means that Dodger makes the kind of damage to him in one day, to repair which one it would take 20 years. So Dodger is very harmful, and Lacy is afraid that he will also go to France and keep a close watch on him. Ralph says, I must, because there is no remedy, but gentle master and my loving dame, as you have always been a friend to me, so in mine absence think upon my wife. So as I was telling you in the last class, that when Ralph departs for war, he requests his friends to look after his wife, or take care of his wife. And Jane laments, alas, my Ralph. And Marjorie says, she can't speak for weeping. Peace, you cracked groats, you mustered tokens. Disquiet not the brave soldier. Go thy ways, Ralph. So Simon rebukes the women. Groats means fourpenny coins. And cracked groats, that is, cracked coins, they are worthless. Master tokens substitute, and hence virtually worthless coins. So, in other words, he calls them worthless. Jane, aye, you bid him go. What shall I do when he is gone? But why be doing with me or my fellow Hodge? Be not idle. So you understand that Farc implies that since her husband is gone, so she can do with him or with Hodge, and she should not be idle. So this is a hilarious parody of the middle class value of enterprise or work. That is, nobody should remain idle. Here, by idleness means that one should not be idle in sex as well. And therefore, she should be doing something with somebody. Let me see the hand, Jane. This fine hand, this white hand, these pretty fingers must spin, must card, must work. So as I told you that the value of working, the ethos of working, was much praised by the Puritans, by the middle class, by the citizens, and actually after Ralph's departure, Jane survives by tailoring and sewing, that is, by working. So Iyer here says that you may have a fine hand, but ultimately this hand must work. Work, you bombast cotton candle queen, work for your living with a pox to you. So again, Simon uses a bombastic phrase. Bombast cotton candle queen means a pricey wench or a girl. A bombast is cotton wool. So expensive candles had wicks of cotton. And the word queen, Q-U-E-A-N, means a prostitute. So he calls Jane both an expensive girl and a prostitute. Fight for the honor of the gentle craft, for the gentlemen shoemakers, the courageous cordwainers, the flower of St. Martin's, the mad knaves of Bedlam, Fleet Street, Tower Street and White Chapel. So Simon here says that you do not worry, you praise the shoemakers, who are all merry people or mad knaves. Crack me the crowns of French knaves, a pox on them, crack them, fight by the Lord of Ludgate, fight my fine boy. So he is encouraging Ralph by saying that you crack some French skulls. So by killing French soldiers, you bring honor not only to England but to all shoemakers. Fight by the Lord of Ludgate. So we find here the reference to the Lord of Ludgate, because Lud was an ancient mythical king of London. So in the city comedy, Lud is referred to again and again, and a kind of patriotism or also love for the city of London is expressed through this reference. Then all the shoemakers give them some money to help him on his journey. Here, Ralph, here is 3 2-pences, 2 carry into France, the third shall wash our souls at parting. So he gives Ralph 3 2-pences, of which he says that you take 2 into France, but the third one we will spend here by drinking before you depart. Wash our souls at parting, for sorrow is dry. So we must wait it with drinking. For my sake, fark the Bazamon queues. Bazamon queues is a malapropism for baiser moqueule, a French phrase which means kiss my ass, a slang phrase. Hodge, Ralph, I am heavy at parting, but here is a shilling for thee. God send thee to cram thy slops with French crowns and thy enemy's bellies with bullets. So Hodge gives Ralph 1 shilling and says that you may fill yourself with French crowns. Now, which as a pun. Crown may mean skulls of the French soldiers, but crowns were also coins. So you may earn some French coins in France. And then Ralph thanks everybody. I thank you, Master, and I thank you all. Now, gentle wife, my loving, lovely Jane, rich men at parting give their wives rich gifts, jewels and rings to grace their lily hands. Thou knowest our trade makes rings for women's heels. Here, take this pair of shoes cut out by Hodge, stitched by my fellow clerk, seamed by myself, made up and pinked with letters for thy name. Wear them, my dear Jane, for thy husband's sake, and every morning when thou pullest them on, remember me and pray for my return. Make much of them, for I have made them so that I can know them from a thousand more. So this speech is important in so far as it gives us the information that Ralph gifts his wife a nice pair of shoes before his departure, and this pair of shoes was made by all of them. So his colleagues, Hodge, Firth, they also contributed to the making of the pair of shoes. And with this, a motif of a luxury item, that is women's shoes, an example of indulgence, is introduced here, because this pair of shoes is not an ordinary pair of shoes, but it is quite elaborate, made up and pinked with letters and so on. So the material objects or things which are considered valuable, and in this play these objects stand for mercantile capitalism. So this pair of shoes has this significance in the play, but it is also an instrument for recognition. So when later people bring to Ralph, after his return from France, bring to him this pair of shoes and tells him to make another similar pair, then Ralph immediately recognizes these shoes. And here he says that, make much of them, for I have made them so that I can know them from a thousand more. So I will be able to distinguish this pair of shoes from thousand other pairs. And when later these shoes are brought to him, he immediately recognizes them. And that makes him look for his wife and to stop her marriage. Therefore, for the recognition of Jane and the meeting of Jane and Ralph in future, this pair of shoes will act as an instrument or a token. Right. Okay. So I'll stop here. If you have any questions so far, you can ask me.